Digitally marketing our business have been gaining traction as our efforts at distributing our FDs from our lending branches. We also owe our growth in retail FDs to our channel partners, including several reputed corporate brokers. We increase our stakes in the housing finance subsidiary, Shriram Housing Finance Limited. We have infused rupees 200 crores in the subsidiary in May, and our stake there is now 81.16%. We intend infusing another 300 crores before the end of FY22. Shriram Housing is a rising star in the affordable housing finance space. The company grew its AUM by 65% year on year. This is indeed to be congratulated, because its AUM is now in the region of 4,000 crores, which places it in the company of peers who are often talked about in current times. Despite a challenging business environment, during which virtually no business was conducted in April and May, this year against the backdrop of COVID, Shriram Housing posted stage 3 delinquencies of only marginally over 2%. The company has embarked on a program to increase its presence in the affordable housing finance space. The program, called Grihaprabhuti, involves leveraging the existing networks of Shriram City Union Finance branches in Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Tamil Nadu, and has already been rolled out in certain Shriram City Union Finance branches in these locations. As I said, we also have Mr. Ravi Subramanian, the MD and CEO of Shriram Housing Finance with us. He will be available for any questions on the housing finance. With this, I conclude my opening remarks. We are now open for the Q&A session.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and 1 on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and 2. Participants are requested to use handsets for asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. First question is from the line of Kunal Shah from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Good set of numbers given the challenging times. Firstly, in terms of this GNPLs, so when I look at the ECL provisions, the increase has hardly been like 70 odd crores in ECL provision. So how should we look at it in terms of the overall credit cost of 290? So were there significant write-offs as well during the quarter, and what would have been the quantum? And maybe, so is that the reason that the gross stage 3 has gone up only by 50-odd basis points?
Kunal, actually, on the stage 3, if you look at it, there were 226 crores of write-offs, which was, if you look at the first quarter last year, it was about 225 crores. So there is nothing there is no significant increase in the write-off. Quarter on quarter, year on year, if you look at it, it is 225 against 226.
Okay. So it's somewhat a similar kind of a number. So it's 225. So maybe almost like 0.7, 0.8% of the AUM. Yeah. Okay. Overall, in terms of the restructuring, it's quite commendable that it's been still managed at a very low number overall when we look at it. So how is there like more to come in, because the window is still open and we could see the flow coming through in Q2, or we are quite comfortable that maybe restructuring compared to what we did earlier of 153 odd crores, it could be lower than that?
It's too early, because they still have... The customers still have time, but as of today, we are not seeing, from the numbers, we are not facing too much of an issue there. So I don't think we could end up doing probably another 70-80 crores of restructuring. At best is what I think before the scheme closes.
Okay, another merely 70-80 crores. So still, that component will still be less than 1-odd% cumulatively.
Correct.
Yeah, sure. And lastly, in terms of the housing finance, if we have to look at it, so obviously stage 3 has been managed very well. But on the restructuring part, cumulatively, if we look at it, this quarter we restructured 72 over and above 58. So now that's more than 3% of the AUM. So anything to read into that in terms of maybe that seems to be slightly higher compared to that of the other affordable housing financiers?
Kunal Ravi here.
Yeah, hi, sir.
Our total restructuring is about 3%, which is about 120 odd crores. Now, out of that, about roughly 30 crores was for our customers who are in the current bucket. So, largely customers who were good customers were impacted by COVID. And if you look at the restructuring that we have done this quarter, they are spread across all the buckets in that sense. So, and most of them have actually paid up the EMIs in June. So I don't think too much of a consequence. And two, I think if you look around and look at most of the industry today, players have actually restructured somewhere between 4 to 8, 9% of their books, and there's more to come. So we are at about 3%, of which about roughly 1% is for the customers who are in the current bucket. So I don't think there's too much of a issue there at this point in time, because all the other vitals look pretty simple in terms of falling bounce rates, our collection efficiency is going up, our collection efficiency despite restructuring going up. So I think overall, it continues to be a good story.
Sure. And it would be a moratorium which would have been offered in terms of the restructuring?
It's a mix of all. No customer has been offered full moratorium. So there's at least an interest servicing component in most of these cases.
Okay, sure. Yeah. And a question to Mr. Chakravarti. So overall, even in this challenging time, last 18 odd months or 12 odd months, in fact, we had seen our book behaving much better, okay, compared to maybe the stress which we had seen earlier, be it in 18-19, where our stage 3 used to be. Even in these times, we have been able to manage it sub 7-odd%. So would it be fair to say that maybe all the initiatives and the efforts which were taken in terms of improving the quality and maybe the ground level initiatives which we have taken, that is leading to it? And structurally, we should see GNPLs and write-offs for SCUF to be lower than what we had seen in last 3-4 years.
Yeah, you're right, Kunal. It's actually a four-year exercise. I think that's what you're seeing over a period of 4 years. We've been constantly trying to, one is the quality, second is actually improve field-level metrics. I think which is working, and hopefully by this financial year end, we should be able to see hopefully improved number from what we are seeing in the Q1.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thanks. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jayaprakash Toshniwal from LIC Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, good morning, sir. Thank you for the time. So just wanted to understand your digital capabilities a bit more, because we are seeing a lot of competition in your segment is coming from fintech player and all. So if you can talk about digital capabilities, particularly in terms of giving top-up loan and accessing the customer on a different for other products per se.
You're talking about assessing a customer based in a surrogate?
Yes.
How do I put this? Okay, let me put it this way. If you look at SCUF's digital journey in the last 2 years, we are also going to put it up probably by today or tomorrow, end of the day today or tomorrow on our digital journey. Today, we probably by end of August, we would be launching a no-contact personal loan, two-wheeler loan on the app, on the web, on the website for our customers. Our fixed deposit program is already online. We have started this journey about 8-9 months back, and today we are doing about 25 crores per month through the online journey, the fixed deposit, where a customer, it's a seamless journey for the customer. Similarly for two-wheeler and as of now, two-wheeler personal loan should be, as I said, done by end of August, and the gold loan by end of November, where including the KYC to KYC documentation, everything will happen online, which will be probably a 5 to 8 minute journey for the customer before his loan is sanctioned. And if it's a personal loan, the money gets hits his account, or if it's a two-wheeler loan, he gets a approval note, which he can just take it to the nearest dealer and get a vehicle delivered. Or if he chooses to, he can get the vehicle delivered to his doorstep. So these are some of the initiatives which are already happening. You will be surprised if I tell you, we have been in touch with a bunch of fintechs with the aim of working, collaborating with them, working with them. Basically, the idea here is to understand what is it that they are doing and how we can adapt it or create a hybrid model of between the touch and feel and the digitization. We actually wanted to create a hybrid model. So to our surprise, I'm not boasting here, but to our surprise, we found that the technology that we are using, or the APIs that we have integrated, we are actually much more digitized than most of these fintechs, the so-called fintechs. So to answer your question in short, probably by the year end, you will see SCUF as a different, totally, probably SCUF as a totally digitally enabled financial services company, including and not limited to these two products that I have said, including the entire product suite. Our collections have already been online for about close to 4 years. There is no physical receipts. The collections happen in a mobile. In fact, our leads for our SME, PL, two-wheeler are generated in a mobile. They're all, and they're, the credit team gets to view them real time. The treasury team actually gets to actually hit the customer's bank accounts probably within 15-20 minutes. Even now, today, we have that capability. We are fine-tuning it. So, as I said, the journeys will start from August.
Okay. Great, sir. Thanks. So, second question to Mr. Ravi, sir. Of this home loan product, if you can give us some idea about the customer profile, about probably its earnings, and also what is the LTV ratio in the home loan product?
So, about 80% of our customers are self-employed, and the balance are salary. So, we are largely a mid-segment self-employed lender in the space. This is a segment which does not interest banks. This is a segment wherein there is a natural moat, because banks find it very expensive to get into this space, because a lot of this is the touch and feel of the customer, which leads to underwriting. We also lend largely to credit-tested customers. We have about 7 to 8% of customers who are new to credit, and the balance are all credit-tested customers. So about 80% of our customers having CIBIL scores in excess of 700. These are customers who have small shops, small merchants, small traders, people who have small industrial units, people who operate out of their own houses, your tailors, your tuition masters, etc. Largely self-employed people who do not rely on the organic sector for their income. And as far as the average ticket sizes are concerned, this is typically about 15 lakh or thereabouts in ticket size. The ticket size is slightly higher in Bombay and Delhi for obvious reasons, but in the rest of the country, it's closer to about 15 lakhs. And LTVs would largely be measured by an external agent or our own technical team, which visits the property and assesses the property. and basis that we give out the loan, our LTVs would typically, average LTV would be in the region of about 55% to 60%, though the range of LTVs would range from 30% to about even 85% to 90% in some cases.
Okay, okay, thanks. So I have two more questions, I will come back in the queue. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shalini Vasanta from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Sir, good morning. This is Vivek here. Actually, what we are struggling with is correlating numbers across organizations, and your performance has been exceptionally good. So do you see, you know, since Mr. Ravi Subramaniam mentioned the civil scores, do you see a migration in civil scores, because May was virtually a washout for most finance companies and your numbers are still strong. Is there a build-up in stage two? Are the civil scores declining? And what explains your strong asset quality, even like say in something like two-wheelers, which usually gets very highly impacted by lockdowns?
Okay. So, see, other than SME, we do not actually take CIBIL score as a parameter for lending. Even in SME, we look at CIBIL scores could be impacted due to various reasons. But to answer your question, since most of these retail products, CIBIL is as of today is not a criteria for us. So I wouldn't know if it is declining, the scores are declining, because again, about as I said, even if we do a CIBIL, about 70, more than 70% of my customers will have a minus one score. That means they will not have a credit history. So that's a customer segment that we address. To answer your question, yes, stage two has increased, but with the one redeeming factor for us is even within stage two, it is more of a 1 to 31 rather than the 30 to 60 bucket that is increased. So most of the increase has come from 31 to 60 rather than 60 to 90. So I think that we are confident that we'll also do a pullback in the next coming in this current quarter from these numbers.
Sure, sir. Thank you. That was very useful. Could I have your stage two numbers in the for March and for June, if possible, because it's clubbed with stage one. So and one and two are clubbed together.
Yeah, the March figure is 7.93, stage 2, now it is 11.768.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much and good luck, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prashant Sridhar from SBI Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, just one data keeping question and one other. If you could give us the breakup of disbursement into top up existing and new customers and how much you would have done under ECL tier. And the second question would be, if you could give us some idea on the on-ground situation or what you're hearing from your customers in SME and two-wheelers. You know, how are business volumes resumed and in two-wheelers, how are repossession trends going, etc. Just these two for my
question. Sorry, you said something about Andhra, Telangana, I missed it there.
No, nothing on AP Telangana, sir. I was asking the on-ground situation in SME two-wheeler and the disbursement breakup into top-up existing and new customers.
See, top-ups, we normally don't, top-ups are very rare. So it would be less than 5-6% of the total disbursement in the quarter. Existing customers on SME would be about 60%. Existing customers, in the sense, customers who have finished their existing loan and come back would be about 60%. Fresh customers would be about 30%. As far as SME is concerned. Two-wheeler, 90% of it would be, there are no top-ups in two-wheeler. Two-wheeler would be, two-wheeler and other products, 90% of that, the no top-ups actually, It could be a repeat customers on the two-wheeler side could be about 20-25%. Rest of it would be fresh customers. Personal loan 100% existing customers. On ground situation, two-wheeler is still not. Two-wheeler has not picked up real steam as compared to the four-wheeler industry. So probably also this month being inauspicious month down south, south is a little slow. So hopefully probably this should be over. This in somewhere in the second week of August. So we expect volumes to pick up in August. SME, there is a demand from small businesses, but then we are also looking at it more closely. In the sense, looking at those businesses a little in the perspective that. What if there is a third wave, what would be the impact on these businesses, and whether what sector that these businesses are in, and we are focusing on small businesses which are actually catering to essential services. So that is what we are driving at, probably that is what we will do for this quarter. And if economy stabilizes and cash flow stabilized, then we will look at other sectors. As far as your ECLGS is concerned, the total disbursement so far was about 90 crores.
Sure. I think around 70 itself was in FY21. Thank you so much, sir. This is very helpful. Just to clarify, you mentioned in two-wheeler, 20-25% of disbursement would be repeat customers.
Sorry.
Sure. Thank you so much, sir.
The next question is from the line of Nischint Chawathe from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. So my question actually pertains to the two-wheeler business. If you look at some of your peers, and very specifically, I can name, let's say, Bajaj, who has something like almost a 19-20% of GNPL in this sector. I was wondering, some of these players have shown a very sharp increase. But somehow in your case, the overall stage 3 has been curtailed, quite a lot. So just wondering, is there anything that we are doing differently, or maybe if you could give some color on stage 2 also for the two-wheeler sector, maybe that can help us to corroborate the numbers better.
I'll put it this way. If you look at my portfolio of two-wheelers, almost close to 80%, 80-85% of my portfolio comprises of Hero and Honda vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Bajaj, I have probably my Bajaj share would be about some 10-12% of my total. Not even 12, I think it's about 8-9%. Right? So, one point. The second point is Bajaj Finance is funding only Bajaj vehicles. Their own issues there. But I think as a resale in the market, I think this Hero and Honda have higher values, so customers tend to, pay you better because they know that if the vehicle goes for a sale, typically it's they will lose. If you look at my portfolio, we also have close to 35% of my portfolio is scooters. The scooters actually perform much better than motorbikes. The scooter segment, the buyers actually are better payers than also motorbikes. So various reasons. The third point, I've always been telling that two-wheeler is not a disbursement business. It's a collection business. So it depends on how strong is your team on the ground, your collection team.
for you to do well in two-wheeler. You just can't leave even one installment on the table. Because if you, one installment is taking away all your earnings over a period of 24 months. So as I said, it's not a disbursement story, it is a collection story, two-wheeler business.
That is true. If you could share the stage two for the two-wheeler business for last and this quarter.
It is around 11%.
Sorry?
It's about 11%.
In both the quarters or this quarter?
Last quarter it was around 8%.
It's actually 11.95 this quarter. Last time it was about 8.5 or so.
Okay, sure. And if you could just repeat the stage two numbers for the overall company as well, because I think I missed it.
Overall company last quarter was 7.93, now this quarter was 11.68.
And for the housing business?
Mr. Ravi, you are?
Ravi? I hope he's not gonna. Just give me a sec, I'll tell you.
Sure.
Not here. Okay, we'll get back to you on that. I'll ask Ravi to answer that question.
No problem.
Ravi must have dropped off.
No problem. We'll connect later. Thank you very much, and all the best.
Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Abhijit Tibrewal from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good morning, and thanks for taking my question. Hello, Chakrabarti sir. Hope you're doing well. The first question was around the digital journey that you kind of talked about, where you are looking to go live in a lot of product segments, some of them by August, gold loans by November. But what I am a little worried about here is, let's say if you are suggesting that we will start doing personal loans using the fintech model or the digital model in the past when we used to do open sourcing.
I'm sorry to interrupt you here, but I think I'm a small miscommunication from my side. The personal loan will be available exclusively only to our existing customers. It will not be available to market.
Okay. So which means, sir, I mean, PL personal loans will continue to remain a cross-sell predominantly to your two-wheeler customers?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry, I think I missed to mention that point. Yeah.
No problem. Thanks for that clarification. The other thing that I wanted to understand, sir, is while you talked about digital coming in your origination and collections, I could not see what is it that we are planning to, I mean, where is it that we are planning to leverage digital to underwrite customers better? Because, I mean, like you are aware, sir, when once we go to the fintech model, and like you only suggested, more than 70% of your customers have a minus one CIBIL score, meaning that it will be very difficult for you to fetch bureau data. Then where is it that you are kind of looking to digitally underwrite these customers?
Sorry, YC, can I just answer that question, the earlier question? I'm back on the call. Nishchint, the stage two numbers for housing are 4.36. Stage 3 are 2.08.
Well, probably they are also looking at a comparable number, in the sense Q1Q or year on year.
Okay, so the last quarter number for stage 2 was 3.2%, and it is 4.36 this time, and stage 3 was 1.67 up to 2.08.
Okay. As far as the question, as far as that the digital is concerned, see, it's not the current customers that I'm looking at. The idea here is by working with on the digital platform side, we are looking at acquiring new customers, new segment of customers, more urban customers. That was the idea.
Okay, so basically the digital journey that you're looking to undertake will help you more on the sourcing side, in terms of looking at a new segment of customers which maybe some of the fintech partnerships can bring to you, and not too much on the underwriting side.
The other one is it will also help us in streamlining our processes, reducing our tax. It will also help us in reducing our tax with our current customers also. Basically, it's not just an online application where customer is doing it. We are also deploying a lot of analytics. There will be a lot of analytics behind it. We have developed our own business rule engines. So we will actually test it out as we go forward and then expand. It's not that end of August, I'm going to start across the country. We're going to test it out in pockets and then tweak. If it's tweaking is needed, we'll tweak it and then deploy. So it will be a step-by-step process. It's not something that you launch tomorrow across the country and then go whole hog.
Okay. So the last question that I had was, and I'm sorry for harping on this again, sometime back, I mean, you were explaining why your asset quality performance in two-wheeler is in stark contrast to what a Bajaj Finance has reported. But sir, fundamentally speaking, I mean, in terms of ticket size, be it a Hero vehicle, Honda vehicle, or a Bajaj vehicle, I would say not too much of a difference in ticket size. Or let's say even if you talk about motorbikes or scooters, I would say I'm just hazarding a guess, maybe 10,000 kind of a difference in ticket size. So in pandemic, I am guessing everyone would have been affected. I mean, be it someone who's holding a Bajaj motorbike or maybe someone having a Hero motorbike. But then, I mean, just because, I mean, our portfolio is more Hero and Honda, I mean, I could understand it could have helped you better on the sourcing side. But how has it helped you on the collection side? And so the last question I had was on Shriram Housing. I mean, you said you're looking to infuse another 300 crores. You are already at about 4,000 crores in AUM. And what we are typically been seeing around that 4,000-4,500 AUM is where a lot of these affordable housing financiers are looking to list. So are we also going down the same way where we will overly capitalize our housing finance subsidiary and then potentially look for an IPO in the next 1 year?
Okay, I'll leave Ravi to answer the second one, but to answer your first question, see, there are certain facts that I wouldn't want to put out in public, but let me put it this way. You go to a used two-wheeler dealer, right? And try to buy different bikes from different manufacturers, you will understand the reason why my delinquency is lower, number one. Because it is also, see, as far as scooters are concerned, it is basically used by the whole family. So definitely the performance will be far superior, pandemic, no pandemic, number one. Number two, let me put it this way. If I am a Bajaj Finance guy and I am financing only Bajaj vehicles in a dealer point, right, I have no choice but to fund majority of the customers who walk into the showroom. Whereas if I am a ex-finance company and I am in, say, a Hero or a Honda dealer, I choose. If you want a much more elaborate reply on this, you can call me.
Sure, sir. I mean, I understand. I mean, I'll get in touch with you.
Yeah. So, on the second question, which is on infusion of capital, I just would like to draw your attention to the fact that in March, when the SCUF board had met, they had approved a 500 crore infusion into Shriram Housing, out of which 200 came in April, and the next 300 will come in on a need basis when we require it. Look, the fundamental ethos of this group is not to just stuff the companies with capital and then pump up the valuations.
I think the fundamental ethos of this group is to give as much capital as required, make that capital run a long distance, and focus on return on equities rather than excess cash in your balance sheet. So to that extent, as we think that we will require the excess 300 crore capital infusion based on our growth towards the end of this year, maybe December this year or maybe January, March next year. That's the time when we are looking at infusing that extra capital, which is on a planned basis. Two, as far as the question on other organizations listing around 4,500 crores of AUM is concerned, well, look, we are already at 4,000. We'll, by the end of this year, be at about 5,500. Now, we will not list just because others have listed at this point in time. We will list when the time is right and when the reasons for listing are right. In fact, a lot of investors should derive in the group should derive a lot of comfort from the fact that the group chooses to invest, to stay invested for a very long time in new businesses and businesses like ours, particularly businesses which have a long gestation period. So the long answer to that, to your question, was that. The short answer is, well, we will consider all the options. If listing is the right option for us to go in, we will go in for listing. But the reasons for listing have to be the right ones.
Sure. David, sir, if I may squeeze in just one last question here. Thank you for that elaborate answer. I remember about a year back, we used to say that we are predominantly restricting ourselves to the six core states. While this time around, we have given a detailed split of our branches statewide. And I see there are another, I would say, six or seven states which are beyond your top seven states. So what's the idea like now? Going forward in FY22, would you be looking to become a pan-India affordable housing player? Or would you still remain concentrated?
Look at that distribution. There are three states of West Bengal, UP and Kerala, where we are there because we historically have had a presence and we have a reasonable portfolio there. We have about 200 crores of portfolio in these three states. And these three states also contribute significantly to the NPA. So we had stopped sourcing 2 years back. For example, last year, out of 2,100 crores, 90 crores came from these three states. But we have stopped sourcing from these, but we are present there because if you exit those states completely, then collections will become a bit of an issue. So we would rather be there, manage our workforce and underwriting and origination properly, and continue to just make sure that we are there and keep collecting. And those are not growth states. The growth states for us are clearly those six states that I mentioned to you. And that's the way it is. In fact, YSC mentioned our Gyarapurthi project in the beginning, in his opening remarks. And as per that project, by December, we will actually be in every nook and corner of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. We'll be opening 170 locations contiguous with the SCUF branch, and that kind of reinforces our thought process that we need to be present in few states, dominate those few states before we go national. I think the days of being India is a summation of 30 countries, so you can't really, you know, be in 30 countries at one point in time and do a good job. So we will focus on these six states. We will try to dominate these states. We'll build our business in these six states. And only after we grow our business in these six states will we turn our focus to the other states.
Sure, sir. Thank you for the patient answering. Wish the entire SCUF team the very best.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Subramaniam Iyer from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congrats on a good set of numbers. Just a follow-up question on the two-wheeler portfolio. I just wanted to check within is your two-wheeler portfolio purely two-wheeler portfolio or does it have three-wheeler as well? Because it also seems that for some of your peers, the challenge was also on the three-wheeler side.
Right. Yeah. To the earlier question, yeah, Bajaj also said that they had a pain point on the three-wheeler side. But it's purely two-wheeler.
Got it.
As far as, anything other than two wheels is slotted under auto loans.
Got it. Thank you. I think that was all. Congrats again. All the best.
Okay, thank you.
Your question is answered, sir?
Yeah, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Prakhar Agarwal from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. Just a couple of questions. So one is, if I were to step back around the quarter and a half back, how do you see...
Sorry, your voice is not clear.
Now is it better?
Yeah.
So I'm saying if I were to step back a quarter and a half back, and in your assessment, how has the portfolio of SME behaved, and do you see that probably we are past that hump, not only for SME, but if at all there is no COVID-free wave, probably we are past the hump on asset quality, or do you see that probably it's better to wait out for a quarter than calling out that hump?
I think we are past the hump. If there are, assuming there are not going to be any more scares on COVID, I think we are past the hump. We are seeing that clearly. Even in July so far, we are seeing an improved numbers.
Okay, sure. And in terms of SME, how in your assessment, whether the behavior has been better than estimates, or probably it has panned out as per your expectations? I'm just asking this question because for other financials.
To answer you honestly, I was surprised actually right from last March because we expected much worse, but I was actually surprised not just leaving aside the disruptions and all. We were pleasantly surprised by the commitment of the customers, a lot of those small customers who have actually paid up. Though their cash flows were struggling with cash flows, most of those people have turned up and paid, which is actually very gratifying when you look at the tickets. When you look at the ticket sizes, average 12, 13 lakhs, and these people, in spite of their problems, turning up to pay you, we are very pleasantly surprised.
Just one last question on housing. Can I look at two players who are operating in a similar geography?
I can't hear you, Prakar. You speak a bit loudly.
So, just on housing, when I look at players who are operating in a similar geography, while we have done relatively well this quarter, but when I look at the overall performance over the last few years, the trend seems to be a little deceptive in terms of their performance and in terms of what we have reported in terms of our asset quality performance.
The trend seems to be what? Slightly?
Slightly divergent. We are slightly on a higher side vis-a-vis those guys. What is the intricate differences between us and those guys, because they are essentially reporting less than 50 basis points of credit cost, 50 basis points of gross NPA, less than 10 to 20 basis points of credit cost, and despite operating 7-8 years into this housing market. And we are operating at a very relatively higher level.
But sir, I have two points to make here, and I'll call a spade here. You need to look at how the SHFL asset quality has panned out over the last 2.5-3 years, and you would see that we've actually dropped from about 5.6-5.7 to about 1.67 as of March 2021 in terms of our GNPA. Two, you need to also look at the fact that my new book, which is roughly about 76% of my total book, which is a 30-month vintage book, has an NPA of about 0.13%. Show me another housing finance company which has 0.13% NPA for the last 3 years of portfolio of last 3 years. Three, I think you also need to ask a question to the industry, that how can somebody who has a margin which is one-fourth of, which is probably three times of HDFC, have an NPA which is one-fourth of HDFC? Now, somewhere something is not right. So
you need to ask those questions and probably go back to those people and ask those questions. But having said that, I think overall, when you look at the nitty-gritties of our book, look at the intricacies of our book, I think we are far than satisfactory, and our portfolio quality, to my mind, what it has been in the last, and I think most of the people on this group will agree, what it has been over the last 2 to 2.5 years has been absolutely stellar.
Okay. Just one last question in terms of just follow up. In terms of operating into this segment, what is one key thing that you probably look at which probably shapes up the difference between various companies? What is one particular aspect that you would probably assign this thing to, if you have something in mind?
You know, the one thing which is most critical when you operate in this segment is your quality of resource down at the grassroots level. And if you compromise on that quality of resource at that grassroots level, you are bound to get into trouble. So if I can stand up and say that what's worked for us, we've hired the best and we've retained the best. And I think that's what has worked for us very well. On the credit front, we moved away from people who have a slightly complicated CIBIL history. We've focused on people who have performed on their past loans. We brought down our dependence on first-time customers, and we have also focused on the quality of collateral so that we are able to repossess and sell those properties. Now, all these things have worked for us in our endeavor to build a good book, and I hope it continues to do so.
Perfect. That answers it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ashwin Kumar Balasubramaniam from HSBC Asset Management Company. Please go ahead.
Hello. Hi. My question relates to your earlier comment on stage two assets. I think you mentioned 11.7 in this quarter and about 7.9, if I'm not wrong, in the previous quarter. So, hello?
11.68.
Yeah. Yeah. So just wanted to know, if this increase which you see in the stage two is it more to do with seasonality, or is this more the impact of this COVID second wave? And if it is the latter, then just a little bit curious to know, we've seen a fair bit of increase in stage two, but not in stage three. Just curious to know why that would be the case, because from what we hear, the roll forward rates in general into further buckets is where people have more difficulty collecting. So just wanted to understand this.
One perspective is we were at 16% pre-COVID, stage 2. That's December 19, we were at 16%. Just to give you a perspective. Now, even within this stage 2, if you look at it, out of this 11.68, about 7% of it is 31 to 60 bucket, so which is basically majority of it is in bucket, the early that thing is, which is basically reason being, see, as you know, we said you already seen that the May there is a lot of disruptions in May, and June it is slowly coming back. So we are not overly worried about a forward flow there. We are pretty certain that we will be able to contain it and pull it back in this quarter. It's mostly branches shut down, people not able to move around, not able to reach people on time. That was the issue.
Got it. Thanks.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Pradeep Agarwal for closing comments.
Thank you, Malika. On behalf of Philip Capital, I would like to thank the entire senior management team of Shriram City Union and all the participants for joining us on the call today. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you all. Thank you.
On behalf of Philip Capital India Private Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.